Subscribe to Femina and press the bell icon.
In classrooms where girls are empowered and given equal opportunities, I think they absolutely shine. But I actually find a traditional work-life balance quite limiting.
She dropped out of Tufts University in America at the age of just 20 to start a non-profit organization. She dedicated her entire life to bring education equality to underprivileged children across the country. In 2019, she was awarded the Jamnalal Bajaj Foundation Award for Development and Welfare of Women and Children.
We have with us today the founder of Akanksha Foundation and the founder and CEO of Teach for India, Shaheen Mistri, in conversation with Femina. Hi Shaheen, thank you so much for being here on the show with us today.
Thank you.
So my first question, I'm going to dive right into it. Girls' education in India isn't really where it needs to be. And despite the Right to Education Act, which was passed 10 years ago, we still see a lot of them dropping out of school for various reasons. But have you seen any change at all in the last 10 years for girls in India?
I'm actually very optimistic. I feel like when you think about where women were 50 years ago, even 20 years ago, and where girls were at that point and today, I think we've made massive progress.
Okay.
At the same time, I think there is a lot of work still to be done in girls' education. And mm-hmm. I think for girls to get what they need, I think we need to sensitize boys as well and shift boys' mm-hmm. education. If I were to elaborate a little bit on that, I think the progress in access has been huge and very significant, both with boys but also with girls. I think that lessens when you look at more marginalized girls. Mm-hmm. So it's still a huge problem, access in pockets of the country, but overall there's been good progress in girls just getting into school.
Okay.
What we've seen in our work is still a too high level of dropout in secondary school and later, which is again something I think we need to work on.
Okay, and in terms of learning, have you seen a big difference between the way boys learn and the way girls learn in school?
I actually think all opportunities equal. Girls tend to do better than boys, which is really interesting. And I think in classrooms where girls are empowered and given equal opportunities, I think they absolutely shine. And we see them taking that education even beyond the classroom to others. So that's been really wonderful to see.
And in terms of gender equality and education equality, which you're trying to bring about through Teach for India, do you see that the boys who come to the classroom, do they bring those prejudices to the classroom that we see around in our society? And if so, then is Teach for India having a sort of program that sensitizes them towards that?
Yeah, I think what our classrooms are is just an absolute reflection of our society.
Yeah.
And we've had some incredibly painful and difficult situations with the way boys have behaved with girls in our classrooms as well.
Right.
I think more than a specific program, what really makes a difference is the teacher and the teacher's own mindsets around equality, diversity, inclusion. And so what you'll find a lot in Teach for India classrooms is teachers like pushing to have girls in football clubs and, you know, teaching boys sewing and like all kinds of things that sort of go against what perhaps boys have traditionally been conditioned with. And I think that's really important.
Mm-hmm.
Doing small things like ensuring that girls and boys' seating is mixed, that girls and boys get equal opportunities to answer questions in class, that where girls are feeling nervous, they're given extra confidence to speak up. Learning circles in the classroom, which are safe spaces for both girls and boys to be vulnerable and really talk about the issues facing them. I think those are some of the strategies that we use.
Okay. And going back to your journey, you started out 25 years ago or so.
Yeah.
And we know this story of how you met Pinky and how the whole journey started. But what motivates you today? Like, has it changed the inspiration for you to, you know, still continue to do what you're doing?
Interestingly, I don't think it's changed that much.
Okay.
I think I've always been a huge believer that opportunity is the most incredible equalizer, and the world is unequal in terms of the opportunities that it gives children. And so I've always been driven by a huge desire to say, can I be part of unleashing kids' potential, because I just believe so deeply in the power of what our children are able to do. So I think that motivation has been really consistent, and the other has just been my deep love and belief in children. I think still today, if you were to give me the chance to do anything with my day, I'd want to be in a classroom with children. And so that's really what fuels, I believe that if we raise our kids differently, our world is going to be different. Like, I have no doubt about that. I think that's what keeps me going.
Okay. Did you face any backlash from people here or at home saying, you know, what are you doing? You're just 20, you're starting this. It's not a good career, not a good job. Or did anyone say you're a woman and you can't do something? Like, did you face any of that?
So I never faced challenges, interestingly, being a woman in this work. I've like counterintuitively often felt that it's an advantage because there are less women, sadly, doing this. So the opportunities that I get, sometimes I feel, well, if I was a man, would I have gotten those opportunities? Or because the pool of women is less, am I getting them? But challenges and questions about what I chose to do with my life, absolutely, I think were there and continue to be there from multiple people. But I think the people who love you, eventually, if they come to see that you're happy and having an impact in the work that you're doing, they come to understand that it was the right choice.
And when you started Teach for India, it started off as a smaller organization. Today, it's quite large. But given that, do you face what all other women seem to face with the work-life balance? Do you find that you still face that issue, or is it not there because you really love what you do?
I mean, I don't believe in work-life balance, so I may be the wrong person to be talking to about this. But I believe a lot in maintaining your energy and knowing what gives you energy and living into your full self and whatever that means for you. But I actually find a traditional work-life balance quite limiting. I've struggled a lot. I have two daughters as well and lots of other interests. So I've struggled to find time for everything that matters to me in my life. But I think it's an ongoing journey. But my belief is, like, to put everything you have into what you do is really very, very important. I think that's where the real joy and the sense of achievement comes from.
Okay. So going back to the classroom, the life skills that, you know, kids need to learn today, I think that seems to be a little missing. We focus on theory, you know, you need to know your subjects. What can we do for that? How can kids learn life skills?
I mean, this is my favorite topic because I think unless we actually change the purpose of education and expand it, I just think nothing's going to actually change, right? So today, if you think about it in India, education really in most schools is about academics, and that too, rote learning to pass an exam, to get into a college, to start the whole cycle again. I think as you mentioned, in today's world, we know that doing that is not setting kids up for success. And that education has to be, of course, about understanding the livelihood that you want and being prepared for it, but also knowing how to interact with other human beings in the world in a better way, and also about making the world better in really significant and important ways. And I think if we expand the definition to that, we then are able to see very different skills that we need to be teaching kids. So we think a lot at Teach for India about 21st century skills. And what does it mean to actively, like we teach kids math and language, to actively teach kids critical thinking and compassion and courage? And what does it mean to have voice? What does it mean to be empowered? What does it mean to connect with others, to be inclusive, to be able to not just raise your voice, which I think we live in a world today where we're really able to raise our voice very, very loudly, right? Because of social media. But at the same time, it seems to me like we're even less willing to accept a different point of view. Absolutely. It doesn't have to shift me and change me, but can I hold it, you know? And I think these are the kinds of things that we need to be teaching in schools.
And what is your leadership style? How do you go about leading people, and from when it was to here it is today? Has that style changed?
It's been such a journey. I don't even know how to answer that question. I think I've changed in really, really profound ways. A lot of the changes have happened directly because of the children that I've met and the communities that I've spent time in over the journey. I think they've been my greatest leaders in what it means to be courageous. I grew up as a painfully shy child and never would have been able to have this conversation in front of a camera with you. So I think my kids have taught me courage. I think they've taught me vulnerability, that I don't need to be perfect, and I'm not. And I can make mistakes, and the beauty of life is actually to be human and to be fallible. I think that's been another big learning. And I think the thing I think the most about is what compassion and love actually means, like not just in our work, but in our world, whether it's loving what you do, loving the people you do it with, loving the world and looking after the world, and practicing that has become, I think, probably the most important part of my leadership style today.
And if you're a leader and a woman leader at that, what would be your piece of advice for any young woman or entrepreneur who wants to start in the NGO space today?
I don't know about advice, but I think I would share with young people today the need to really like stay with something that you believe in. I feel like what worries me a little bit about this generation is the jumping from thing to thing versus like becoming really great at something and devoting yourself to it, because I think it just takes time to do something well and to have any kind of impact, no matter what you want to do in the world. So I think often when people say, what are you most proud of? I say it really what I'm most proud of is just that I've stayed on the path, because there have been so many ups and downs, but just staying and having that commitment to something that you believe in, I think that would be my advice.
Thank you so much, Shaheen, for being on the show with us today. Thank you.
Thanks.